much. I don't think I can live up to that, but okay, well, first of all, let me welcome all of you to WSO2Con Europe, the third time in Europe, as Ishii mentioned, and the second time in London. And we look forward to having a wonderful 3 days with you. Well, 2 days. You've already been here for 1 day, at least some of you. So I'm going to spend not too long, but I want to kind of give you a broad perspective of where WSO2 is coming from, the way we think about the world, and the way we see things moving, and then talk very briefly about what we're doing so that you can kind of get some understanding. Of course, there are lots of sessions, so the sessions will give you more information about most of the product spaces. We have so much stuff going on that we don't really have enough sessions to cover everything. That's really why we have the WSO2 lounge outside. So if you have any particular thing that you want to get information about, ask some questions, get input, get some suggestions, there's going to be WSO2 people hanging around there all the time, and they are designed to answer any question you can ask. So if they don't answer it, that's a bug and we'll fix it. All right, so let me get started. So I'm going to introduce myself slightly differently. I am the founder and CEO of the company, but I'm also the chief architect. So I took on this role formally after Paul went off to do his PhD, but I've been doing this for a very long time. So I'm a very technical person. I am very passionate about what we do, and very passionate about it from every dimension of it, not just on the technical side, but about the business model, about being 100% open source, about the way we work with customers, the way we market, all parts of it. I tend to think very long term, so I don't get heated up about any particular hype, whether it's API management or microservices or IoT or whatever the buzzword of the day. We don't get too excited about it, and we kind of look at everything as a solvable problem. It's just a matter of time. And we tend to, the last point is very important, we respect and appreciate our customers. At the same time, we view it as our mission and our responsibility to guide you guys on the technology direction, not the other way around. So we certainly welcome input, we hear your thoughts, we love the scenarios, we love the input and the challenges, but fundamentally we do a lot of things on technical direction because we think that's the right way to do it, and sometimes we disagree and have arguments about it. And that's part of the way WSO2 works, and it's been a fundamental part of how we've got to where we are in the last 10 years, nearly 10 years. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of all that to give you a bit of an understanding of what we are about. So let me start. So what we do is enable you guys to build connected applications of various kinds. So our mission is to help people connect people, applications, and devices. And what that means is to really get as close as possible to customers, get allow people to build on you and kind of be creative in ways that nobody has envisioned before. And this is not something that, when we first started talking about this stuff, it was like kind of novel, but it's not novel anymore. Everybody's talking about the transformation to digital business and how everything is transforming in the economy to a much more connected environment. And this is something that you cannot avoid. So just to give an example, we were talking to one of our customers over dinner last night, and they mentioned that 30% of their website traffic is a screen scraping done by third-party vendors who are screen scraping that to provide an API for new applications to be built. And they are doing a transformation so they can get offer those APIs directly. What that shows is, well, if you don't get in front of your customers, get close to your customers, somebody else will do it for you. Right? And by doing that, they are deriving more value than you're getting out of it. So there's a lot of things that you have to do as quickly as possible to get into this connected world. Otherwise, you have the opportunity for all kinds of digital revolutions that can displace the business model that you're in. So that's what we try to do, enable people to do this. Of course, it's not easy, right? So if you are an enterprise architect, you're a CIO, you're a CTO, you have pictures like this all the time in your enterprise. Any real organization has all kinds of internal spaghetti that connects everything together, keeps the lights on, and keeps systems running. So it's not something that's very easy, right? And it's not something that can be done quickly. It's something that's going to take a lot of effort on a long-term basis to actually transform from the reality of the ugliness that we all live in to this beautiful API-centric connected devices and sort of all, you know, intelligent experience that we're all looking forward to. Of course, we vendors don't like that complexity because it's hard to sell it. Everybody likes to simplify things. I don't know whether you know this concept. Snake oil is a very American invention. Snake oil was something that was created, I think, in the 1800s as a mythical solution to pretty much everything. So the idea is that whatever the problem is, you just apply some snake oil and the problem gets solved. And that's what a lot of, you know, a lot of vendors generally come and tell you, oh, just buy this SOA thing and it'll be solved, or buy this API management thing, it'll be solved, or buy this big data thing and it'll be solved. And we technology people tend to want a silver bullet solution. And snake oil vendors thrive perfectly in that because, oh, it's a silver bullet, so let me just sell you some snake oil that you applied and you get your silver bullet. Of course, the way this comes about is really driven out of this quote, which says, if you only have a tool, if the only tool you have is a hammer, you tend to see every problem as a nail. Right? And technology providers who have one piece of technology have to pitch the story as a snake oil solution, because you just apply the technology and, whoa, magic happens, and you get you know, going from ugliness to beauty. And the underlying reality, of course, is much more difficult, but this is the way people tend to do things. By the way, there's a debate about who came up with this quote. Abraham Maslow is a very famous psychologist. Maslow's hierarchy of needs, if you've read about that, it's very cool. But there's another person who apparently said, so I don't know, but this is the one I found. So so a lot of the people operate in this mode where you have a single vendor who has one thing, and then, you know, you pitch that as all you need to do is API management. You put API management, everything is fine. But then somebody goes and buys an analytics company, and then it becomes API management plus analytics. Now you need big data and you need API management. Then everything is fine once you have put those two together. Or there's another vendor whose mission is to say there's no more software. Except that they also have a platform on which you write software, because nobody can really just use a SaaS application and be done with it. And similarly for ESPs and so forth. So the idea that you can solve all these problems with one solution really doesn't work, and you need a much more comprehensive story. But if you go to most of these vendors' websites, they will talk about a platform as this is the platform that solves all your integration needs, all the architecture needs, and the future. And of course, one product is not a platform. You need a lot more than that. And that's really where we've been working on for a very long time. So we are now nearly 10 years old. We're going to complete 10 years in August. And our job is not to push this problem to you, not to try to solve it simply, but we try to make a lot of decisions for the customer into what is going to work and what the future is going to be. One of the key things that we see ourselves as responsible for is to make the right technical judgment calls. So if you've been around the block for long enough, you know about JBI, SCA, all these various things that come about that have incredible market momentum because a few key big vendors will choose to push it. But yet, it doesn't really solve the underlying technical challenges that anybody has. But sometimes market momentum can make it go anyway. But of course, sometimes it doesn't. And these are both examples of things that, despite a lot of push, they both never made it. And nobody really talks about them anymore. So part of our mission is to do long-term thinking on this and figure out not a sort of a snake oil solution, or what Paul used to call drive-by architecture, where you kind of look at it quickly and say, oh, just do this and you're done. And it doesn't really work like that. So we tend to look long-term about this and say, what are the things that are going to work long-term, and why does it work and how does it work, and try to implement that. So I'm sure everybody's familiar with the Gartner hype curve concept, right? So there's the peak of inflated expectations, there's the trough of disillusionment, and then there is the plateau of productivity. So when some new thing comes about, we try very hard not to get caught up in the hype going up, but really look and say, what does this mean? What's really long-term about this? Whether it is cloud or API management or analytics or device management or IoT, whatever. We tend not to worry about getting up on the curve, just jumping up along with it and riding that, because we are not a company that was designed to just ride some wave and get out of it. It was a company designed for the long term. So we tend to look at what is the final path for this new iteration of technological innovation. And then try to say, okay, that's where it's going to land, and figure out how to transition or incorporate that idea into whatever we are building. Right? And that's really how we think about all the technical challenges that we work on. A key part of that, of course, is the comprehensive thinking about the platform. We don't think about one particular aspect of the platform. We try very hard not to focus on just API management or just integration or just device management or whatever the current topic is, but really look at why do you need all these things and how do they all fit together into the whole architecture of what we are trying to do. And of course, hard problems are hard to solve, but that's okay. We are in it for the long term, and we know customers, even though everybody wants to solve their whatever the immediate problem immediately, People also realize that a lot of these are things that have to go through transformations and transitions within the organization, and it's often not all about technology. Right? It's almost never about technology. It's not a matter of buying something and putting it in. It's also about changing the organization, getting people to learn, changing the mindset, getting the management model, getting the reward model changed. All of those things have to be done. And therefore, it takes a long time. And so our vision is to be with the customer and support that long-term engagement to make it work. So this leads me to kind of packaging up the way we've thought about the company from the beginning. These are sort of fundamental driving concepts that we set up when we started the company nearly 10 years ago. Right from the beginning, we set out to build a complete middleware platform. We were not trying to build one product and hit the right market wave with it and be done with it, but looking always at the whole problem of middleware and saying, how do you solve that problem? What's the right approach for solving that problem? We run the company in a very different way. We are now nearly a 500-person company. We have no managers in the company. We have a lot of leaders. We have people whose job it is to provide leadership and people whose job it is to give guidance and kind of drive and lead people. But we don't have anybody who's sitting there just managing. Right? Then we operate in this mode of a lot more self-motivated, self-generated execution and create an environment that people can work in a lot more cohesive and integrated fashion. Right? And I'm a longtime member of the Apache Software Foundation. Apache piloted many of these approaches for how you make decisions, how you work in a community, how you work amongst a group of people at large scale. And we are applying all of those things in WSO2 and also have evolved them to suit a commercial organization versus a sort of a nonprofit model. Also, the company is very global. I myself live in Sri Lanka. I lived in the US for 16 years. I went back in 2001, so I've now been back for nearly 14 years. And the company operates very heavily out of Sri Lanka. Actually, 95% of our 500 people live in Sri Lanka right now. And we have offices in the US, in UK, and just opening in Brazil, and a few other places. So it's a global corporation. It's not an outsourcing model, which is a very common thing when you have people in that side of the world. It's much more of a single global org chart that is driving an innovation platform, trying to continuously recreate and create new ideas as we go along. Open source is fundamental to the way WSO2 is designed and the way WSO2 works. Open source is something that I personally am a long-time believer in and have been involved with for a very, very long time. And we see open source not just as a way of creating a market and selling the software, but also really as how we develop and how we operate. So most companies that have open source products today are really not open source in the sense of how open source is supposed to work. It's not really community-led. It's not open as to how decisions are made. Conversations are not available for other people to participate in and so forth. So we do all of that completely openly. And we also don't have any kind of open core, completely sort of a enterprise version, community edition kind of model. It's 100% open source. And as a long term, even from the day we set out, we set out to say we're going to take down the middleware leaders of the world and become the number one middleware company in the world. We're not there yet. It's only 10 years. It's going to take a little bit longer than that. But we are well on the way. We have a lot of stuff that's coming along into the right path, and it's we're very confident that the platform that we've built can keep on scaling and can keep on supporting a larger and larger customer base and a lot larger problem space as well. So we are nearly 10 years. We'll be 10 years in August. And really, we are the only company that has built a middleware platform ever. So if you go to IBM, Oracle, Microsoft, anybody, this is all a bunch of acquisitions that are beautifully marketed together as a platform. You go to pretty much any startup company, they're a one-product company. They built one product, they sell that product, and maybe when they go beyond a certain size, they need more revenue, they go and buy something else and add that on. Right? You see that happening over and over again now, or maybe actually implement something in some cases. But no one has taken on the entire middleware space and said, we're going to go and solve everything from business process management to cloud to analytics to security to API management to integration to dashboards to UIs to data integration, all of that in one integrated architecture. And that's what we set out to do, and that's what we're doing. And that's a very unique thing, and it's very important that it's not led by acquisition. Because if you lead by acquisition, then the price of that is actually being paid by people who use the integrated stuff, because it's not really integrated. We also happen to be the only one who offers all of that in multiple deployment choices. So everything from downloadable open source that you run on your own platforms to completely cloud infrastructures, whether we run it for you, you run it on our shared infrastructure, or you run it in your private cloud. All of it available in the same mode, basically. And the last point is very important. Middleware is not something that you can completely solve in any short order. Anybody who tells you that just apply this and it'll be done is completely, you know, lying to themselves, because whether it is XML or JSON or HTTP or MQTT, whatever it is, doesn't really matter. The technology is going to keep on evolving. Computing as a discipline is only 60 years old. Civil engineering is 5,000 years old, and people still come up with new ways of building things. And if computer science is done in 50 years, we are all, you know, very not creative. So I certainly hope it's not done, and we don't believe it is done. And our intent is not that we will stop, but our intent is to keep on reinventing ourselves as quickly as we can, while supporting the reality that somebody who adopts our stuff has to stay up with it, but keep reinventing it and then supporting customer needs as they go along, right? And reinvent it, always looking long-term down the road. We tend to look at 5 years and 10 years down the road when we do something. We don't look at for next year, right? So sometimes that annoys people because, like, well, you know, if I just have this, I can solve this problem. We do that as much as we can, but if we only do that if it fits our 5 and 10 year roadmap. Right? And the roadmap is not written down. Roadmap is all intuition that's in the system that we operate on. Because it's really not possible to write down what the technology roadmap is going to be for the next 10 years, because it's all going to change. No matter what anybody writes on, it's going to change. So we tend to iteratively improve that as we go along every single day. So our long-term objective is really not just be a vendor. We are looking for a way to build this company into something that can closely collaborate with customers as a partner. And that's very important to us because, that's, again, obviously it's you know, helps us become a vendor and get more deeply connected to the customer, which means more revenue over time. But at the same time, it's also an opportunity to really deeply understand what are the needs of the world, what are the challenges, the real large-scale challenges of enterprise architects and enterprise scenarios, and then continue to support that as we go along. So this is something that we look at on a daily basis, because this is not something we set out saying we're just going to do this for a few years and be done with it. So when we're looking at 10 years, we're just finishing 10 years. We just last week we had a planning session kind of thinking about the next 10 years, saying what are we going to do? What are sort of the principles of WSO2 for the next 10 years? Not really technology planning. You can't plan technology for 10 years, but more the principles behind the company and the vision for the next 10 years. And when you operate in that mode, it's very important that we don't look at a customer as, okay, we can get this much money out of this guy right now and then we're done, right? It's more of how can we help each of these customers become a deeper and longer term connected business so that as they go on and they evolve and they become more successful, we become more successful. So it's a partnership, not just a vendor relationship that we're trying to achieve. All right, so this is the long-term stuff, but I'm also going to give you take a little bit of time in the remaining time to give you a little bit of short-term updates. We do have to make some money, so we ship some products and stuff here and there. So API Cloud is live, so that's great news. It was announced last year in beta, and now it's commercially live. We actually, the day it went up, we had our first paying customer. And it's a part of our whole API management strategy. And that's kind of important because we are the only company, again, that gives the same API management software in whichever way you want. So if you're a customer who's technical and you don't want to even pay for support, you can just download all the code and just use it. And we have no problem with it. We hope you'll give us a case study. And I know there are a bunch of people here who are like that. This is fine, right? That's why we are open source. We want people to use it. We want you to buy support if you want support. If you don't need support and you're able to manage it, no problem. And of course, if you're on-premise and you need support, we can sell you support. Then we have the public shared cloud. That's the one that just went live, API cloud. And also, we have a concept of managed cloud, which really is about allowing people to deploy the software and for us to deploy and manage it. And I have a slide on that next. I just want to talk a little bit about the cloud, what we're doing. So again, if you look at API management in the cloud, there's a bunch of vendors who do API management in the cloud. What differentiates us from everybody else is not just that we have the world's best API management product, but that's one little point. But it's more that API management is not some isolated piece of work that somebody has to do. API management comes in the context of services that actually offer the API. So somebody has to write and manage and deploy those services. That's where AppCloud comes. And then people consume those APIs and create applications. Again, AppCloud can help you create applications that consume these APIs as well as other APIs and to create new applications. And then as IoT gets going, devices become more and more important. And as you plug in a device, a device shows up in the device management cloud as a managed device. The API for the device will show up in the API cloud as an API, so you can program against the device. And any data coming out of the device will feed into the analytics cloud, so you can analyze it. Right? All of this powered by a single platform. And that's what we're building. So it's not just a separate, disconnected cloud, but one cloud that puts all the products and capabilities we have into a single platform and makes it available for anybody to use. Managed cloud, I mentioned managed cloud. This is basically where we operate the cloud, a cloud deployment for you. We have a lot of customers who are adopting this. So customers are using AWS or some other infrastructure provider and then asking us to deploy and operate the software for them. So it's essentially a private deployment for the customer, and it's becoming quite popular. What's underneath a lot of our cloud work is Apache Stratos. Apache Stratos is a system that we originally developed as WSO2 Stratos and donated to Apache nearly 2 years ago. And Apache Stratos is a widely used PaaS platform, and it competes with Cloud Foundry and a few other things. And the advantage that Stratos has is it's very flexible. It's a lot more composite. It's a lot more powerful in terms of dealing with composite applications than Cloud Foundry or OpenShift. And also now with the latest version that's about to come out, it supports both Docker as well as a normal VM kind of model of deployment. And Stratos has capability to run anything on top of it. So App Factory, which is what's behind the App Cloud offering, is on Stratos, and App Factory then will get the ability to run PHP to .NET to whatever application types that you want underneath that. Just talk briefly about the analytics stuff. So we've been working very heavily on the analytics platform. We have we've been looking at the entire analytics platform and really understanding what does it mean to take data and analyze it. And we have four different scenarios of analysis that we are supporting. So first is interactive analytics, where you can basically look at the data and sort of like Logstash, Kibana kind of experience. So you can interactively query and look at the data. Next one is real-time analytics, which is what the complex event processor does. And then machine learning and batch analytics. So the key point here is analytics is not equal to big data. A lot of people confuse big data or a Hadoop vendor and say, oh, that's my analytics story. But Hadoop is very important if you're doing batch analytics using Hadoop. But it's not an analytics solution for what you're trying to do. So what we are trying to say is, OK, we want to look at the problem of saying I have a set of information coming in from someplace. And then I want to be able to analyze this in various ways. Sometimes I want to store it and analyze it. Sometimes I want to analyze it real time. So store it and analyze is basically what our previous BAM product used to do, which we've renamed as a data analytics server. And we're also moving from Hadoop to Storm because we find that Storm is a lot more scalable than, sorry, to Spark. We are integrating Storm to CEP so that we can scale the CEP server using streaming capabilities of Storm. If you're interested in any of this stuff, our analytics people are here, so there's a couple of talks as well, and feel free to talk to people. And then the interactive analytics was very powerful, so you can get the data into an analytics infrastructure and then query it manually and sort of do various kind of things. Machine learner is an important one, just coming out in another month or so. Machine learner basically lets you take all the stored data and apply machine learning algorithms to it. Compute a decision function, and then apply that decision function back again, both for real-time analysis or any other kind of decision-making within the organization. So that decision function can pump back into the ESB for a decision in the business logic, or it can pump back into the complex event processor for interactive or real-time alerts based on computer decisions. Again, based on a lot of open-source capability. And the important point I want to point out about DAS, about the data analytics server, is really a platform for us. We view data analytics server as not something that is an end solution. On top of that, we are creating offerings that are targeted on the particular use cases. So for API, for example, we are creating an API analytics offering. So that basically integrates all the API-related event streams, writes all the API-related analytics, has a bunch of dashboards and so forth, so you plug that in and you get full API analytics out of it. And similarly for other areas, right? So this is the way we see customers using DAS as well. You take this analytics platform and then integrate all the other capabilities that actually do the business scenarios for you. App Manager is an interesting product. We just released it. It's a combination of an app store with single sign-on, with centralized policy management, and all kinds of analytics. So the idea is, within an enterprise, you typically have lots and lots of web applications, first focusing on the website. So you have a lot of web applications, which are basically URLs in various places. So this lets you centralize all that into a single portal. So you have a website, which is now your app store. And then if you're logged into the app store, it can SSO you onto the other site. So then it'll, and that way you have to have a single password, username password. Second, it also gets all the analytics out of it. Right? And also it integrates to our mobile app management. So if you have a mobile device management, and then those applications can also be integrated to the same app manager. IoT is an important area, so we are doing a whole bunch of things with IoT. Of course, IoT is not an area by itself. IoT touches the rest of the enterprise in many ways. So first thing is that IoT devices have to integrate to the existing IT world. So there's a lot of integration needs coming out of that. And then all the event streams that are coming out of IoT have to be dealt with. All the devices have to be dealt with. Security is an important topic. Scalability, of course, is important, being able to handle lots and lots of large number of devices and manage them. And then be ready for whichever way the world turns in IoT, because it's not, you know, this stuff is still coming along, and there's a lot of changes that will happen both in the technology, hardware technology side, as well as the software side of the world. So our reference architecture for IoT has a model where we have the devices connecting either directly or through some kind of a gateway to our integration platform, and which then ends up offering APIs. So application developers can use those APIs to control and build applications on top of those devices. All the events coming out of the data, all the sensor data, will get fed into the analytics platform, so you can now analyze that data and do whatever you want with it. And of course, the management infrastructure comes in through the management interface of the device to manage it. So we support both the device manufacturer side as well as the device user side of the problem. So if you are a device manufacturer and you're trying to build a nest-like experience for a new IoT solution, this framework can be used as an open source embeddable platform that you integrate to creating your that experience. Right? Or if it's an end user, then you have a whole another set of capabilities. On the business side, I want to do a shout out to all our channel partners. We have more than 100 partners signed up to work with us now in 44 countries, and we have 15 of them sponsoring this conference, so thank you very much for that. And channel is a very important part for us. It's really what allows us to scale. As a company, we are nearly 500 people, but for the kinds of problems we solve and the scale of problems we want to solve and we can solve, 500 people is a drop in the bucket for what you need in order to do that and also do it at a global scale. So having presence in all these countries and having the relationships in all these countries is very, very important. So we certainly appreciate the support that we've received from partners, and we look forward to really pushing that forward as we go along. Very briefly, two more slides, I think I'm done. WSO2 Telco, so this is an offering that we announced at the Mobile World Congress in February. This is a set of products that are going to be going after the telco software market, focused on the telecommunications operator infrastructure, basically. So our long-term strategy for WSO2 is WSO2 will remain a horizontal technology platform independent of any particular vertical domain, whether it's telco or financial services or healthcare or insurance or retail or manufacturing or whatever. But then build, along with partners, focused offerings for particular verticals. So this is the first one of that. WSO2 Telco has been done with one of our current customers, ASEAN Digital Services, which is a Malaysian telco, and they're about a $6 billion company, telco. And this platform was actually what was done originally internally for them with us to build internal API management and mobile connect capability. And now this is going to become its own organization, basically, and become an entity that offers full product support and product roadmap for the telco space. Right? And this is a blueprint that we hope to follow over the next 10 years as we go along and build out the company. And this is a very important product that was announced April 1st this year. If you didn't see it, you can, unfortunately, the download is not available, but the manufacturers are somewhere around here, so you can always check it out. And finally, just before I wrap up, I just want to touch a little bit on upcoming talks. So Simon is coming up next. So Simon is a very long-time open source innovator, inventor, founder in many ways. And open source is very, very important to us because it's becoming more and more important for customers. So first of all, it's important to us. It's some principles that I personally deeply believe in and will not give up for the company, because that's what's really important for how we form this vision. But more and more enterprises are recognizing that open source is not just about having open access to the software, but also the level of flexibility that the software gives to the business and allows them to innovate and allows them to think differently without having the major control point on that software by the vendor. And so that's why we're pleased to have Simon come and talk about open source, because it's such an important area and something that's going to become a lot more important as we go along. And then after that, we have Alexis and Tyler talking about containers. Of course, unless you've been living in a cave, you know about containers and Docker and all this stuff these days. Alexis is a long-time contributor in a bunch of areas in this, and Tyler will talk about how containers affect the developer ecosystem and how that gets going. And Paul Fremantle, who is my co-founder and currently on leave doing a PhD, is going to be back tomorrow to give a talk about IoT security. And then we have an interesting panel about IoT, because again, it's an important area and there's a lot of cool stuff that our customers are doing with our products in the IoT space. And we'll end with Asanka, who's our VP of Solutions Architecture, talking about how you build actual connected business solutions, and also a panel on connected business on all this about how to build a connected business. And of course, there's a whole bunch of other talks. I don't mean to devalue any of our other valued speakers. And we also appreciate all the customers who are coming here to talk and give presentations. We had more presentations than we could handle, as always. And so we really appreciate the time and the contribution. All right, so finally, in summary, I'm going to leave you with this thought that if you're on a long-term path, don't look at snake oil. It doesn't really solve the problem. And we as a business are here for the long term, and we are looking hard at how to do it right for a very long term and be your partner for the next 10 years just to start. Finally, I want to invite everybody to join our 10-year celebrations. We are officially celebrating our 10-year anniversary on the 4th of August. And we have a week-long set of activities planned. We have the Asia conference from August 3rd to 5th. And then on Thursday, we'll have another event and another thing on Friday. So would love to see everybody in Colombo. Sri Lanka is a number one travel destination these days. So it's a great place to travel. August is a good time to travel for people in Europe. And weather in Sri Lanka is okay in August. Not the perfect time, but it's good enough to travel. So hopefully you can make it. And thank you very much.